Good morning. Welcome to the session 6 of this microcontroller, timers and serial port module 4. Last class, we were in the assembly and C programming of a simple serial port. Transmission of a message was done. So today we have to do the reception of serial data. So we have finished so much in module 4. The 8051 timers and counters are done, along with serial communication, wherein we had covered the basics of serial communication, that is parallel versus serial data transmission, the RS-232 standard, the 9-pin RS-232 signals. Then we were in the simple serial port programming in assembly and C language for transmission of a message was done. Today we'll be doing for receiving a data serially, the assembly and C program for receiving a serial data. So for this, the procedure, how do you program the 8051 to receive the data serially? First, we have to generate the baud rate or the serial clock. To generate the serial clock, we generally use serial mode 1, wherein the baud rate is variable and it is provided by timer 1 in mode 2. Mode 2 is auto reload. So this is almost constant. The T mode is loaded with 20H. Then for the required baud rate, TH1 is loaded with the initial value, let us say minus 3, minus 6, etc. And SCON is 50H. This describes serial mode 1. In serial mode 1, we have timer 1 in auto reload condition, that is mode 2, with 8-bit data, a start and a stop bit. And since we are using receive, we have turn REN bit, that is a receive enable bit, also on. Then we start the timer by using the TR1 equal to 1. As soon as you say TR1 equal to 1, the timer starts operating, and hence the serial circuitry is given the clock. So for reception, we have to turn on the RI flag, clear the RI flag. And as soon as a character is received completely in SBUF, as soon as a character is received in SBUF, the 8051 will set RI equal to 1. This indicates that it has a valid data in RI, and this SBUF has to be copied into an accumulator and stored in some memory location or sent to a port, etc. So if you do not copy this, SBUF will be overwritten with the new data. So monitor till RI flag goes high, and as soon as RI flag goes high, it implies that a character is received complete in SBUF, and read the SBUF for the received character and store it in a memory. Then repeat from step 5 to get the next character, that is clear RI flag again. And this has to be done by the programmer, it is not automatic. So clear RI flag so that the next reception is enabled, and you keep waiting till RI flag goes high. So clear RI, RI is made 0, and you keep waiting till again RI goes high. When does RI go high? When a character is received completely in SBUF. And read the SBUF register for the received character, and you repeat from step 5 for get next character. So this is the initialization of the serial peripheral for receiving data serially. The initialization consists of TMOD with 20H. So this implies that we are using timer 1 in mode 2. Mode 2 is auto reload to generate the serial clock. And we are also loading TH1 with the required baud rate, that is the number, initial value. Then SCON is 50H. So this is serial mode 1, wherein we use the TMOD, the 8-bit data, start and stop bits. Start the timer so the baud rate is generated. So this portion is the initialization of the serial peripheral. So once the serial peripheral is initialized, now for reception, we have to use the RI flag. So clear the RI flag and wait till RI flag goes high. So once RI flag goes high, read the SBUF. After reading the SBUF, you again clear the RI flag for the next character. So this is for the baud rate generation. So we see that the crystal oscillator is divided by 12. and that is divided by 12 by UART, internal UART, and you have the TR1 over here. You're starting the timer, and this timer starts working. The timer here at this point, after divide by 32, suppose I have a crystal oscillator of 11 megahertz, 11.0519 megahertz, and it is divided by 12 and divided by 32. Then I get an exact 28,800 hertz. Suppose if it is 22 megahertz, etc., you get a decimal point here. But this 11.0598 megahertz, whatever we are using till now, that XTAL, that one, when we divide by 12 and divide by 32, that figure gives me exactly 28,800 hertz. And that 28,800 hertz, if I divide it by 3, I get 9,600. Similarly, divide by 6, 4,800, and so on. So depending on the baud rate that is required, this TH1, that initial value should be loaded. It should be loaded with either minus 3, minus 6, or so on. This we have covered in last class in detail. Let's just recap. The procedure is same for reception. For receiving the data serially also, we have to agree upon the baud rate. And for agreeing upon the baud rate, since it is timer so one we are using in auto reload, TH1 has to be loaded with the initial value. And what value we will load? So look at the internal structure when I use it in serial mode 1. So this is SM0, SM1, serial mode 1, SCON equal to 50H. Crystal oscillator output is divided by 12, divided by 32, that I get 28,800. And that is further divided by 3, 6, 12 or anything to get the standard baud rates. The standard baud rates are 9,600, 4,800, 2,400 and so on. This is the importance of the receive interrupt flag. It is set by the hardware. RI is in the SMOD register and this is there. You can use RI directly. In previous case, we were using TI. This REN is already set. So the serial data modes, that is SM0, SM1. So we are using SM0, SM1 as mode 1. This is 8-bit UART. This is variable and set by timer 1 in mode 2. We are seeing this baud rate settings. The mode that we have to set is SMOD 1. And to transfer the data serially, remember, this is just a comparison. So the first portion should be the same. Transferring is 20H, loading this and initializing SCON is 50H. You're starting the timer, clearing TI. So instead of RI, you are using TI. So first four are same. Then instead of RI flag, we were using TI. And here we were moving the data to be transmitted into SBUF. And you're waiting till TI was set. And afterwards, you're repeating. For reception, we are clearing RI flag. So first four will be same. We will clear RI flag. And then we wait till RI becomes high. And once RI becomes high, we read SBUF. Here we are transmitting data into SBUF for transmission. For reception, after RI becomes high, we read. So the TMOD for both the cases, we have 20H and SCON is 50H. So let us recap the SCON as 50H. Serial mode 1, then I have disabled the multiprocessor communication. You enabled the serial transmission. It's an 8-bit data transmission, so TB8 and RB8 are 0. And we are clearing both the TI and RI flags. Then let us go to a small program wherein we have receiving the data serially. And once the data that is received serially, that parallel data is sent on port P1. Port P1 is an 8-bit port and the data is sent to port P1. So you're receiving data serially on RxD pin. You're receiving data serially on RxD pin. After reception, that 8-bit data that is there in SBUF, you're sending to P1. So the algorithm is simple. First is initialization. For the initialization, so the initialization is TMOD is 20. THN is minus 6 for 4,800 baud rate. So this is 4,800 baud rate. It is minus 6. For the minus 6, I have to load FA. So FA, how do you get FA? This is 256 minus 6, that is 250. 250 in hexadecimal is FA. So TH1 is 0x FA, this is in C. SCON is 0x50, TR1 equal to 1. So this first four lines are same in C and as well as in assembly. TMOD is 0x20, hexadecimal 20. TH1 is for 4800 baud, it is minus 6. SCON is 50, hexadecimal, and start the timer. So once we do this, then this is an infinite loop. So while one, continuously, first we have to wait while RI equal to 00. Wait till RI becomes 1. So as long initially RI will be 0, indicating that it is waiting for serial transmission. So start the timer. So the serial port is enabled. After the serial port is enabled, you wait till RI becomes equal to 1. So as long as RI equal to 00, you just wait. And once you have completely received SBUF, you put it in a variable. The variable that we have used is MyByte. So the MyByte is defined as a character, unsigned character. So it's an 8-bit data. So that SBUF is moved to MyByte. And from MyByte, it is moved to P1. Okay, P1 is a port. You have to send it to port P1. Then make RI equal to 0. So once again, I have to get the next data. So make RI equal to 0. And this is a continuous while one loop. This is completely a while one loop. RI equal to 0. And you go back here and wait till RI becomes 1. Once it becomes 1, read SBUF value. Read SBUF value into a variable that is MyByte. From MyByte, you move to port P1. So it is displayed on the port. So the serial data has been converted into parallel data in SBUF, and that you convert, send it to port P1. And once again, clear RI and repeat it. So the C program, as usual, has it registers 51.h and void main. And you are defining one variable, that is MyByte. So unsigned char MyByte. That is followed by initialization, and that is followed by while one loop. The same thing, this is instead of a port P1 here, we are using sending it to port P2. And not only sending it to port P2, we are also storing it in a memory location 62H. So difference between this program and this program is, you're receiving the serial data and we are placing it in a memory location as well as sending it to port P2. So the first few initialization line, this is in assembly. The previous one example was in C program. So for C program, TMOD is equal to 0x20. So here we say move TMOD is equal to #20h. This is assembly level language program. And here we have move TH1 0xFA. 0xFA is 4800 baud. Here they haven't mentioned the baud rate. Since they have not mentioned the baud rate, you assume the baud rate as something like 9600 baud rate. This is standard baud rate. And for this 9600 baud rate, TH1 value is equal to -3. TH1 value is -3. So move TH1 is -3. Then SCON, move SCON with #50h. So that will give you the serial modes as mode 1, and you're going to enable the receive, the 8-bit transmission, then the start and stop bit. Then start the timer. Start this timer. So the first four, move TMOD 20, move TH1 -3 for 9600 baud rate, then SCON with 50H, and start the timer. That is set B TR1. Previous case, set B TR1 is TR1 equal to 1. This is in C and this is in assembly. Assembly, you are setting the bit TR1. Then we are clear the RI, this is the receive. So clear RI, the receive interrupt flag, you RI flag, you equal to 0. And JNB RI wait. Wait till RI becomes 1. As long as RI equal to 0, you keep waiting. And once RI equal to 1, that implies that SBUF has the 8-bit data which it has received serially. That 8-bit data you copy into the accumulator A, and from accumulator A you copy into the memory location 62H, copy it into the port P2, and S jump again. So you keep jumping again. So here we have chosen two programs. Both programs are similar with a slight difference in the baud rate. One is 4,800. This is 9,600. Here the data that is being received is sent to port P1, and here the data that is being received is sent to port P2 and also stored in memory location 62H. So the previous program here, this was chosen to in C, okay, and here this is chosen in assembly. So you have an example of assembly level language program, ALP, as well as C language. Both of them are similar. Only for C, you have to include the headers file, that is hash include register 51.h, then void main. After this, you have to declare some variable because we don't have the registers here. Then accumulator register R0, R1, etc. So you have to, what you can say, declare a variable. After that, the initialization is same. TMOD 20, TH1, SCON, and TR1. Similarly, here we are using mood TMOD with hash, and these four lines are same. Then clear RI, then wait. So this JNB RI wait is completed as while RI equal to zero. Then move that into my byte variable. From my byte, you move to PI and make RI equal to zero. Assembly also, you're same. Clear RI equal to zero, RI equal to zero. SBUF, you're moving it to A. From A, you're moving it to port as well as a memory location, and you're jumping again. So these two are simple programs which tell you how to receive a data serially. Then the same program, once again, as I said, this program, we will convert it into C. So the first is include register 51.h. Then I have one receive data variable and one value. Then this is the TMOD 20, TH1 FD, SCON 20, TR1 equal to 1, start the timer. This is the initialization part. After the initialization part, you have the while one part. In the while one part, while RI equal to 00, wait. And once you get put SBUF to some value, you put it to port P2, and also you put it in a memory location. The receive that as a memory location. Then make RI equal to 0 and come back to the while loop. So this is again exact copy of this program. This program is written both in ALP as well as C. So this is the initialization, and this is the main program to receive the data and put it in a port P2 as well as in a memory location. And every time you have to make RI equal to 0. Then keep waiting till RI becomes 1. While RI equal to 0, keep waiting. And once RI becomes 1, you come out of this loop. Then we have certain extra programs on serial transmission. So we have finished program examples with serial reception. So we have some extra programs on serial transmission. So this is one example wherein we have to transfer a message S serially. Okay, so as such, TMOD 20, THI minus 3, that is nothing but FD, that is 9600 baud rate, SCON is 50H, TR1 equal to 1, start the timer. So these four lines are the initialization. Then while one, here we have used a loop. In the previous example, we used to have something like waiting in the main program. Here, since we have more than one character, let us say YES, so we are putting in a subroutine. So you're using a subroutine here for transmission. This is a void SCRTX. Void SCRTX is the subroutine for transmitting serial data. And the input to this is an unsigned CARX, an 8-bit data, which has to be transmitted serially. So as we were saying, the serial transmission is being put in a subroutine wherein one we pass a message to be transmitted. So X is a byte to be transmitted. So that X is sent to the subroutine. And that in the subroutine, X is put into SBUF. And after you put it in SBUF, you keep waiting till TI becomes 1. So once TI becomes 1, it implies that it has been completely transmitted. Then make TI equal to 0 and come out. And in the main program, since we have to transmit three characters, Y, E, S, so you say serial transmit Y. Y is in single quotes. It will send the ASCII value. Then serial transmit E, then serial transmit S. So all three lines are being transmitted. All three characters are being transmitted one after the other. But here, instead of writing this transmission one three times, or we are putting it in a subroutine. It is a subroutine which will do the transmission. And to the subroutine, we are just passing the character, either Y or E or S. And this is once again, you're transmitting instead of yes, you're transmitting a hello message continuously. And this is previous one was a C program to transmit yes serially. So this is a C program to transmit yes serially. This is an assembly level language program to transmit hello continuously. Here also hello, we are putting it in a subroutine. So the initial portion TMOD 23, that is 9600, SCON 50, start the timer. Then we are moving A with H and we are A call send. A call send is a subroutine in assembly level language program, which is used for serial transmission. Then again, move A with the hash E. E is in single quotes or double quotes. So similarly, H-E-L-L-O. And we are going to S jump again. Again, we are going to do it again. And what is the send subroutine? The send subroutine, accumulator A, we are putting S buff. So here we are passing it through a register. The register is A. It's an assembly level language program. Previously in C program, we were passing it through a variable X. So we're using a variable X. We are in a C program, we can't use the registers. R0, R1A and all. So we rather use the variables X. Whereas in assembly level language program, we can use registers. So the register A, which is containing either H, E, L, L, O or whatever, that is moved into SBUF. And once again, in the this is a subroutine to transmit serially in ALP. This is in ALP. The previous program was in C. So JNB TI to wait, jump on borrow till you get, then clear TI, make the TI equal to zero and return. Once again, check this again should be here. There's a small mistake. This sub again label should be at move A, comma hash H. Okay, this is for hello. This again should be here. And this is your C program wherein hello, instead of sending H separately, E separate, L, L, O separately. And even in the C program, we have previous C program, we were sending Y, E, S separately and using the subroutine. Instead of sending one character at a time, this whole string, we can use some strings. Okay, we can use some string and such as a unsigned character message, that is hello. And we can use a loop for I equal to 0, I less than 5. So H-E-L-L-O is 5 characters. For I less than 5, I plus plus, message of I. So when I equal to 0, the message of I will get me the character H. That will be put in SBUF. And you wait while TI equal to 0. That is wait till it is transmitted. And once it is transmitted, clear the TI and then go back. And this is the end of while loop and this is the end of main. So in this program, instead of sending one letter at a time, H separate, E separate, L separate and all, we have put it in a message that is a string. And you're using a for loop to access that string. For I equal to 0, I less than 5, message of I. Message of 0 gives me H, message of 1 gives me E and so on. Each time you get one character from this message, put it in SBUF and then once you put it in SBUF, since the TR1 is started and this initialization is done, it will transmit. And once the transmission is complete, the TI will become 1 and you come out, make TI equal to 0. So enable further transmission. So we have done some 4 programs now to transmit and all. So this is a huge one. The earth is but one country. In the previous example, we have seen we have used a string hello in C. Same thing instead of in C, we will write it in assembly. and we'll make it a bigger string. For example, the string is the earth is but one country to serial port, and once again the crystal frequency is 11.0592 megahertz and 4800 baud. So SCON is 50, TMOD is 20, and TH1 is -6. So the -6 is 4600 baud. And then start the timer, SHB TR1, start the timer. And once it is over, you just jump over. Once you the initialization is over, go to sending the message. Go to sending the message. And what is the message? The earth is but one country. So you have initialized the timer here. After that, in the sending the message, what do we do? Move DPTR. In the C program, we are using for loop. But here we are using DPTR, a data pointer, to point to the message. Message, you write it at the end of the program before you die the end. This is DB, this is defined byte. So this is a string. So open the quotes of the string, close open the string, comma, zero. This is the null character that specifies the end of the string. The earth is but one country full. So here in the previous example, we are counting hello, H-E-L-L-O was 5 characters and I was using a for loop. So once a string is very huge, we don't count the character. Rather, we use a null character. And once you get a null character, you come out of the loop. So this message one, this is a data array created in ALP. This is your ALP. Whereas in C, how do you do it? Unsigned char message open close equal to hello. This is in C. This is how you specify a character in C. Whereas in a string in assembly, you give the name of the string. The name of the string is message one and DB. The type is defined byte. Every character here is of the defined byte, and the complete message is the earth is but one country. And you end it with a null character. And in the main program, you move DPTR with hash message one. When you say move DPTR hash message one, it load with the starting address of this message one. So the starting address of the message one will point to T. So the load address to this, then clear the accumulator, move C from the external memory, move C at A comma DPTR. That is, this will move the T ASCII value of T into A. And then check whether it is end of the line, jump on zero to S1. That is, if you get the null character, that is a zero, you get a zero here. That means it's a null character and you have to exit the loop. Else, what do you do? If it is not the null character, this has to be transmitted. So A call, send com. So send com is your subroutine here, which is going to transmit the data. Then increment DPTR. So you're going to increment DPTR. First we have transmitted T, then to transmit H, and then E. We have to increment the DPTR. And then S jump FN, that is you keep repeating it, wherein again you clear the accumulator. Move from the new DPTR value, incremented DPTR value into accumulator A. And then again, you check whatever value you moved into accumulator A is zero. If it is zero, you exit the loop. Else, you call the subroutine to transmit the data. The subroutine to call the transmit the data is A call sendcom. So in sendcom, the data that is there in A, the character that is there in A is moved to SBUF. As soon as you move it to SBUF, since the serial port is already initialized, the timer is also started, that will be transmitted on the TXD pin. And once it starts on the TXD pin, you keep waiting till TI becomes 1. As long as TI equal to 0, jump on no borrow TI equal to here. As long as it is 0, it keeps waiting. And once TI becomes 1, it comes out of this clear TI for the next one and you return. So this subroutine is fixed. Accumulator to SBUF for transmission and wait till JNB till TI. Okay. And then once TI becomes 1, clear TI and return. Equivalent C program will be while TI equal to 0 semicolon. Keep waiting while. After that, TI equal to 0 and send com. So this program is wherein we are using a string. This is in ALP. Previous example was in C. Hello, well, you had an unsigned cat message. This is a string. And here we counted the number of letters, H-E-L-L-O, that was 5. And we used a for loop for I equal to 0, I less than 5. And we took message of I. Whereas in this ALP program, since the message is huge, the string is huge, and we may make a mistake, what we have done is we have at the end of this, we have typed in the string message 1. This is character type DB, defined byte. Then we have put the complete string, comma, and we have ended with a null character. And in the main program, you move the DPTR, that is data pointer with the message hash message 1, the address of the string. Then clear the accumulator, get from this, and once you get a character from the string, check whether this character is 0. If this character is 0, it shows it's a null character. Then you end this loop, end this jump on 0 to S1. S1 is exit. Okay, that exit I haven't written here. Exit, you can write it outside. Then else, what do you do? S call send com, call the transmit, increment DPTR, get the next character. Then S jump FN, go to this function. So this is a complete ALP to send a big string. This is still more complicated program wherein we are sending it to a PC, the message we are ready. And apart from this, the data, both the send and receive programs. The previous was only the sending program or transmitting, serial transmission. Here, this is a program which has both the serial transmission, that is send, and we are also having serial reception. So both we have, and this is a structure of this program. Here we are writing a program to send to PC the message we are ready. This is to PC on the TXT pin. On the TXT pin, we are sending the message we are ready. So on the TXT pin, we are sending the message we are ready. And any data that is being received, sent by PC, that is on the RXT. The PC is connected through COM port to RXT. PC is connected to the 8051 through the COM port. And on the RXT, whatever we are receiving, that is being sent to the LEDs. That is being sent to the LEDs. That LEDs are connected at port P1. And we also are having port 2 in input mode. Port 2 in input mode where we have certain switches and whatever data is there on the switches, that also we are sending it to PC serially. And to the PC, we are sending two things. One, we are ready. That is, one is we are ready. Second, whatever the switch status is there. Switches status are there on P2. That is being read in parallelly, converted serially and being transmitted on the TXT pin. So the program should perform part A once. The part A is we are ready to PC once. But part B and C, part B is receiving the data from the PC and sending it to the LED. Receiving from the PC on the COM port and sending it to the LED. And the switch status on port P2 to the PC. So these two, part B and C, that is COM port data to LED and the switch status to PC. This has to be done continuously. And the baud rate is 4,800. So initial part A to the PC should be only once. The rest are same. So this is the main program. Once again, we need to make port P2 as an input port. Port P2 as an input port, make it as hash 0FF. And this is the initialization of the timer. T mod is 20. This is divide by 6, minus 6, and S con is 50. Start the timer. So this is the initialization of the teapot. And we need the pointer for the message. The message we have stored at my data, hash my data to TPTR. And we are getting the character. So clear accumulator and get the character from the DPTR. And then check out once again if it is the last character, if it is the end of this, it is 0, if it is a null end of the string, you get out of the loop, go to P1, else go to the transmission, serial transmission. Then increment DPTR, get the next character and jump in the loop. So this loop continuously sends VR ready signal to PC. This is done only once, and once this is done, it will jump JSA to B of 1. So the B of 1 will be the two pads, B and C pads, that is read the data on P2 and transmit it serially, and also get the serial data from the COM port and put it in the port P1 and sjump B1. So this is continuous. That is, read the data, that is the switch status from P2 to accumulator A, and call the send subroutine, that is transmit it serially. Then again call the receive subroutine, get, and then whatever is received on RxD from the COM port, send it to port P1 and display it parallelly on P1. So these two are done continuously. So once again, this is a send subroutine, transmit subroutine. How does the transmit subroutine work? A to SBUF, keep waiting till T1 becomes high. Once T1 becomes high, clear the TI and return. What about a receive subroutine? So here A is moved to subroutine. In receive subroutine, you wait till RI becomes high. And once RI becomes high, the received data in SBUF is moved to A, and you're clearing RI and your return. And the data, what is the data? My data, DB, we are ready. That is followed by zero. The zero is a terminating character, and this will show the end of the string. And once this end of the string zero is received, so it'll come out, JSA B of 1, that is, it'll come out of this routine. This H1 routine is to send this message, my data message. And after this, the B1 routine is done continuously, where the two parts B and C are done continuously. This is a serial data transfer subroutine, and this is a serial reception subroutine, and this is a message that is stored. Then let us look at certain lab programs using Keel. So let us have a small program wherein 8051 microcontroller is transmitting a character to a PC, and we'll display it on the serial port. So the algorithm is the same. Timer 1 initialization using TMOD register for the baud rate. TH1 is the initial value. SCON is 50H, and you start the timer. We are transmitting the characters Y and E by writing into the SBUF register and waiting for the TI flag. So this is the ORG0. Once you write it in the Keel subroutine, you have to specify. You're starting at 0, and 0 we are having sjump 30H. We are skipping the vector table completely and going to 30H. From 30H, ORG30H, you have the main program. Between 0 to 2FH, you have the vector table, inter-vector table, which we are not using here. So once in 30H, TMOD 20H, TH1 is minus 3 for 9600 baud, SCON is 50H, and the receive enable, set B start the timer. This is the initial value. Then move A with the hash Y, transfer Y. A call transmit subroutine, move the accumulator. So the accumulator, I can use as capital A or small A. Here it is. Then this is hash E. These are the registers. A, capital A and small A are the accumulator register. Then you are transmitting Y, and they are transmitting E, A call, and S jump again. So here S jump again 1. I am here itself. So once you are here, this YE will be transferred serially only once. And what is this transmit subroutine? Move A to the SBUF, jump on no borrow here. As long as TI equal to 1, be there, clear TI. Once it is there, you go back and you return. So how do you see the result of this program? Select the debug session, go to the debug session, that is your run, and then you review it in the serial window. Then you, each time the program is printed on the subroutine, you can see that Y is printed on the program. So let us view it in the Keel subroutine. So once again, we will have the Keel subroutine wherein we will share the, I am sharing the screen for the Keel subroutine. Okay. So this is a Keel subroutine. The program has been already loaded. Okay, let me do it from the beginning. I'll just say project, I'll just come out of the debug window. So this is project close project. So we can have a new project, or I'll open a existing project. So the project is something like timers. We have named this as timers UV. I have added the serial1.asm, the same file I have just shown you. Okay, that has been typed here. org0sjump30h. Then tmod is #20h. th1 is -3. And sjump again 1. This is a transmit subroutine and a return program. So let us compile this. So this is rebuild all target files. This has been compiled. And we'll go to the debug session. Start the debug session. So it's come to the debug session. And here, I'll close the serial window. I'll show you. Go to the view. And this is a serial window number 1. Just open the serial window 1. You can see that nothing is being printed here. Then keep the cursor here. Okay. So keep the cursor here again. And I can use go to run to cursor line. Here you have this run to cursor line. When I say run to cursor line, it has executed till here. And I can see that on the serial window, YE is printed. So again, I can here it is only once. Only once YE is printed. Even if it is, I'll just say reset. Reset again, it has come to S030H and I will run continuously. Even if you run continuously, only once YE is printed, because you have your sjump again 1, and sjump again 1 implies that you're going to run it only once again. So instead of this, I want to have a continuous start again. So instead of saying sjump again 1 being here, I'll just say sjump again. So instead of again 1, we'll go back and again keep printing yes. So I'll just remove this 1 here. I'll remove this 1 here and I'm going to jump again. Go back and keep transmitting YE. So save this, rebuild all the files. Then go to the debug session. And in the debug session, you can see that the serial window we already opened in last session, it is 0. Then once I start running, can you see it is keeping, it is running. I'll just halt. So each time you run, you can see YE, it's continuously printed. So you want to see this, okay, I just close it again. Then again, view the serial window. Okay, this is, I had to clear the serial window, clear window. So this is a fresh window. Then I'll just reset again. Then you go to again 1. At this point, you keep the cursor. Then run till cursor. Okay, reset. So this is my cursor. Then go to run till cursor. So each time you press, first time I press run YE. So again I press, again I press this run till cursor. Okay, I click on this, go to this run till cursor. So it has run till here. Again I get the next YE. So you can use a continuous mode and this is transmitting. So you can change the numbers also. So instead of YE, you can give something like 1, 2 and so on. Come out this. So instead of YE, we can write it as 1 and 2. So you can execute all these programs in the same way. You can check it out. So this is save, rebuild. Then go to the debug window. Okay. In the debug window, the serial window is there. Come till here. That is again 1. Okay. And I don't want this complete window to be jumbled up. Till here once. So you can see that 1, 2 is printed instead of YE. So same way you can keep working with different ones. Okay. So let us come to the come back to this main one. On the same lines, you can have a timer delay program wherein you're illustrating the timer delay. Here you have setting up the timer in mode 2 and you are generating a 0.05 milliseconds delay. And so I need a 1 second delay. So the time of 1 second is very large delay. So load TH1 with 118. This is mode 2 operation. Maximum TH1 can be 256 FF. So load it for 0.05 milliseconds. And this 0.05 milliseconds repeated 2000 times. So when you repeat it 2000 times, 0.05 milliseconds, when you repeat it 2000 times, 100 into 200, 20,000 times, 0.05 milliseconds into 20,000 times, you get 1 second. So you need two registers. One register, you load it at 100. Outer loop, another 200. Inner loop is 100. Outer loop is 200. Like that, we get 20,000. 20,000 times, the timer will overflow. And each time it overflows, it is counting 0.05 milliseconds. And 20,000 times it overflows, you get 1 second. So you write the main program, that is the reset vector. Here we are using the timer in the interrupt mode. Actually, the interrupt mode comes in the next module. So whenever the timer TF0 overflows, we can use it in the polling mode or interrupt mode. Here this program is written for interrupt mode. As soon as the interrupt occurs, it will sjump to ISR. And in the ISR, first we write the main program here. The main program is accumulator 0, register R0 and R1 are both 00. Then the T mode is 02, that is timer 0 in mode 2 auto reload. And TH0 is 118. This is for 0.05 millisecond. And then since we are using interrupt mode, we have to enable the timer 0 interrupts and enable the interrupts. So IE is 82H. This IE will be done in the next module. Then you're starting the timer. You can say set B TR1, TR0. You can say set B TR0. Or you can use tcon.4. Previous session, we have shown how you can use this. And sjump here. Main program doesn't do anything. Just it will initialize the registers A, R0, R1, all with zeros. Then it will initialize the timer 0 in mode 2. And then it will initialize the initial value in timer 0. The initial value is 118 for 0.05 milliseconds. And it will enable the interrupts. It will enable the interrupts. It starts the timer. And it is here. It is waiting here continuously. It will not do anything. In the interrupt subroutine, first you have to disable the timer, stop the timer, then increment R1, okay. Compare whether R1 equal to 100. If R1 is not equal to 0, you just skip to the jump, that is the start the timer, and return by enabling the interrupts. Again, the timer is started and you go for the next. First time 0.5 millisecond occurs, the timer overflows and it will go to the ISR. As soon as TF0, the timer flag 0 is overflowing, it will set it interrupt. Timer flag interrupt, that interrupt is at 0BH, ORG. As I said, ORG 00 to 30H, 2FH, before 30H, 2FH, it is the vector table. And in the vector table, the 0B address. The 0B address is for the TF0 vector. And in this vector, once it comes to 0B, when does it come to 0B? When the timer 0 overflows. So when the timer 0 overflows, it will come to this vector. And in this ORG 0B, what we have written? Sjump to ISR. So this is your sjump to ISR. In this sjump to ISR, we are stopping the timer. Then we are incrementing register R1, telling that it has overflowed once. And we are checking whether R1 equal to 100. If it is not so, we start the timer again. And we return from the interrupt. And again, the timer will overflow. Second time, it will overflow. R1 was 1, it will become 2. And again, still it is not 100 and it will repeat. Suppose R1 is 100, then what it will do, it will increment R0. It will increment R0. Here R2 is R0. And it will check whether R0 is 200. If it is not so, it will skip and it will go on doing. This is an inner loop and outer loop. Totally, by the time R2 is R0 and R1 both are 100 and 200. Again, you reinitialize R0 with 00. and you increment A. When are you incrementing A? After 1 second has passed. When does 1 second pass? When R1 is 100, when R0 is equal to 200, and each time you have the timer counting 0.05 milliseconds. Total, this is an example of a large delay generation, and this is done in the lab program. You can do it in the lab program, and you can check the result in the accumulator A. You can see that the accumulator A is ticking from 0001 to till FF, and it is doing for every 1 second for 33 megahertz clock setting. And if I use 11.0598 megahertz, you have a target. On the target, you can click and set the options. Since it's in the simulator mode, you need not have to set 11.0598 megahertz. You can, the default target is 33 megahertz. For 33 megahertz, this is calculated 1 second. So if you recalculate it for 11.0598, it is for 3 seconds. So in the simulator, you can use other one like 22 megahertz we have used. So any other one setting, you can use it. Since it's in a simulator more in Keel, you can change the settings and you can do. So let us recap some video old question papers. So previously this was there in as an elective in fifth semester, some few question papers are there, Jan 2018-29. So this 8051 syllabus, as I said, is a very old syllabus and it is available at a wide number of places. So in a Jan 2018 paper, we had described the various modes of operation of 8051 timers. So the various modes of operation of 8051 timers are mode 0, 1, 2, 3 that we have done in session 1. Create a pulse width of 50 milliseconds on port P2.3 using timer 0 operating in mode 1, and crystal frequency. This is also has been done for both 5 milliseconds as well as 50 milliseconds. The square wave of 1 kilohertz using mode 2. This is auto reload. Mode 2 is auto reload. And we have done this square wave of exactly 1 kilohertz. Okay, and that has been done for timer 1. You change it for timer 0. And this crystal frequency is 22 megahertz. There are problems with the 22 megahertz also. Then list the advantages of serial data communication over parallel. Compare serial and data communication and explain briefly the details of SCON register. This also has been done. And transfer a letter M serially. So we had transferred a letter Y serially. So in that Y, you replace it by M. Through port P3.1. Here, remember this port P3.1 is nothing but your TXT pin. Okay, this is your TXT pin. And then this is another one. Write an ALP, C program to receive data byte serially and put them in port P1. Exactly, we have got the RXT, that is SBUF. SBUF, you put it in variable my data and send it to P1. Set the baud rate. So all the questions are comfortable, or we have done. And then this is what are timers and counters, the difference between timers and counters. That also has been done in session 1. Explain timer control register, that is TCON, and explain TMOD. So TCON, TMOD, you have the complete screenshots explained. Explain the 8051 S-CON. Actually, this is a mistake. This is S-CON together. Explain here, this paper has explaining you only the registers. TCON register, TMOD register, and an S-CON register. For example, if they ask S-CON register, you have to explain. S-CON has having the so many bits, SM0, SM1, SM2, receive enable, TB8, RB8, TI, transmit flag, RI, receive interrupt flag. So how does it work? Then SM0, SM1, how does it work? Two modes, 0001. SM2 is multiprocessor mode. So that should be 0. If you want receive enable, REN should be 1, and so on. So this is a little tedious if they ask like the TCON register, TMOD, and SCON. Remembering is also difficult. You don't know at which places these bits come. So what you can do is generally, what is SCON? what are all the bits. It has the serial mode bits and this RE and TBA. Because everywhere we are using SCON as 50H. Till now, for all years, whether it's serial transmission or reception, we were using mode 1 and 50H. So now you can also check out here. Then the handshaking signals, RTS and DTR that we have done. All 9 pins we have explained. So in that 2 pins you explain RTS and DTR. And we had sent YES C program serially. So in that YES you change it to GOD. Got. So a slight change in the data that you're going to transmit. And this is once again another question paper. Again, it is repeated. What's the difference between timer and counter? Explain the function of each bit in TMOD register. TMOD, you remember, bottom 4 bits are for TR0, that is timer 0. Upper 4 bits are for timer 1. And in each of these 4 bits, you have 2 bits for mode M0, AM1. And then another one is C/T-bar. And the last is gate. So for almost every program, you have to explain the TMOD register. So here we need not have to do the TMOD. You have to explain the bits of this. And once again, a square wave of 3 kilohertz frequency, 50% duty cycle. What do you mean by 50% duty cycle? T on equal to T off. And it is 3 kilohertz. We had done for 1 kilohertz. Previous program was a square wave of 100 kilohertz. So they'll be changing only the frequencies. Okay. Another program, this one was for 1 kilohertz. So there are different frequencies, 1 kilohertz, then 100 hertz, 100 kilohertz, and this is 3 kilohertz, etc. Each time the T equal to 1 by F, that will change according to the given frequency, and T on equal to T off is equal to T by 2. Once you get that T on or T off, from that you calculate the initial value to be put into the THX, that it can be timer 1 or timer 0, mode 1 operation, that is maximum it's a 16 bit, 2 power 16. Then advantage and disadvantage of mode 2 when compared to mode 1. Advantages, in mode 2 it is auto reload. We need not have to load the initial value again and again. Disadvantages, maximum it can have is only 256, 00 to FF. It's an 8-bit counter, whereas mode 1 is a 16-bit timer. It can give you a larger delay compared to mode 2. Then write the steps required for programming 8051 to transfer and receive the data serially. This also we have done at different places. Session 5 also was there, and session 6 also we have recapped. And write an ALP to transfer Y serially. So in the previous example, they had given something like H serially. So this is, this was for to transfer a letter M serially. Here they're asking for letter Y serially at a baud rate. So only slight difference in this. Explain the importance of TI and RI flag. So we have explained. So this is receiving, as I said, the TXD pin. And importance of RI flag. So by checking the RI flag when it is raised, we know that the character has been received and sitting in the SBUF register, and we copy the SBUF to a safe place. Otherwise, what it will be done, it will be overwritten. But what happens if we copy SBUF before RI flag is raised? Before RI flag is raised, if you copy SBUF, you copy some jumbled data. So similarly, if you copy SBUF before the RI flag, we are copying some jumbled data. So how do you check the RIB? JNB RI XX, keep varying, or you can use an interrupt. So we haven't done with using an interrupt, that is the next module. So here we use JNB TI for transmit. So they've asked the importance of RI and TI flag. So explain in step, what is the importance of RI flag? What is the importance of TI flag? It is there in the course of this presentation, as well as in the notes that are there. So how do we do? For TI flag, you have to explain for TXD. So I think we have come to the end of this session, and we have completed module 4 of this new VTO syllabus 18. EC46. So apart from your textbooks and reference books, that 80 Intel's 8051 microcontroller user's manual has also been used extensively in this PPT. It's a standard reference manual. So you can also go through it. And so thank you.